So we'll prove the hinge theorem and have a little bit of fun here. The hinge theorem goes all the way back to Euclid. He called it the open mouth theorem, or it gets referred to that way sometimes. And I had some fun with this, meaning that I created some cool things in the animation, which I will take some time and I'll show you how to do that sort of thing at the end of the video. Okay, so what is the hinge theorem? Well, let's get the basic setup. So it says that if two triangles have two sides congruent, okay, so and the included angle of the first is larger than the included angle of the second. So we're saying that the blue angle is between the two sides that are congruent in the blue triangle, right? And this green angle right down here is smaller, strictly smaller. Okay, so the setup basically is that we have two pairs of sides congruent, and then we're comparing the angles between them, the blue angle being larger than the green angle. Okay, so what our setup does, this is our first cool part of the animation, is that we're going to align the triangles so that A prime B prime sits on the line segment AB, right? And you can see it slot in there. And just to let you know, the A primes and the B primes disappeared, and so did the angles down here. So that was intentional. And again, we just want this setup, both triangles superimposed on one another. And next, we're going to create the angle bisector of angle CAB and put the intersection point E where it crosses this side of the triangle AD, A prime D B prime, which is now ADP, ADB. Okay, well now we have side angle side congruence. Let's walk through that, right? So of course we've just created the angle bisector, so we know that these two angles are congruent. By the reflexive property of congruence, the segment AE is congruent to itself, and by the given, the side AD and side AC, those were congruent pairs of sides from the given of the theorem. Okay, so by side angle side, we have triangle EAD is congruent to triangle EC. Excuse me, EAC. All right, and because of that, then we can say that these two sides, which I've marked in orange, are also congruent. Okay, and now we're done because we can use the triangle inequality. So we're going to use the triangle inequality on segment BC, and it seems pretty clear that it's less than BE plus EC. And therefore, BE, well, you can see it here, right, that it's less than BE plus EC, of course. It seems smaller, but remember, this could be, we could extend this line, right, C, could be way out here, and it may not be quite as clear depending on where it is, and the distance between D and C. This may not be quite as clear a relationship. So let's use, and we also don't really have any other way other than the triangle inequality to prove distances are greater or less than other distances, right? So BC is here. And in this small little triangle, BC is less than BE plus EC because any one side of the triangle is the length of any one side of the triangle is less than the sum of the other two lengths of the sides. And then we can swap EC for BD because they're congruent. So therefore, by the triangle inequality, the reflexive property of congruence, segment congruence, and then doing a little substitution, we prove that BC is less than BD, which was what was required. Okay, so now let's look at some of those animations. Let's jump back. And you have to see there's a slider going on, obviously. I guess you guys could have guessed that. And so the slider, is moving. And then let me show you how to set up these points, right? So if you take a look, I defined a prime in terms of a. And so the slider goes from 0 to 5, right? So this 5 minus r, when r is 0, it's 5, right? So we've moved d 5 units over, excuse me, a prime. A prime has gotten moved over. You can see better. Let me draw that better, right? You can see that a prime gets moved over. And then the vertical shift is just a little bit. I did this 1 plus r minus 5. So when r equals 5, this is 1 minus 1. And of course, the y value is 0 and it's sitting down here on A. And let's just show this a little bit. You can see how it moves, right? So this is r gets bigger. When r gets to 5, right, I have 5 minus 5, which is 0, and then it's just the x coordinate of a. This is also an interesting one that you should learn, that I can refer to the x coordinate or y coordinate of a point, like that. So I'm able to define a prime to be this little formula in terms of my slider r. Okay. And b is the same way, the exact same thing. Now D was a little different because D isn't the same point as C. Basically, it was when I was graphing it initially, when I was putting it together. Sorry, this was. Let me try this again. This point, I made C 3, 1. They had to have the same length, so I made C 3, 1, and D was 1, 3, with A at the origin, right, to make sure that this congruence actually was correct. And so this 4 minus is actually a 3 plus 1 minus R, right? So it has the same setup as the 1 minus R over 5, but it's 4 plus 1 minus R over 5 to get D in the right place. And then again, it's 1 plus 5 minus r instead of 5 minus r, again because of its x coordinate. But that's what makes the slider work, is defining those points in terms of this r. And so as r gets bigger, they get closer and closer. All right, now also notice that there are angle marks that disappear as we slide over. Right, and that's intentional because we're gonna have the congruent angles come in with the angle bisector, so I wanted those to disappear. Also, you can see that the A prime B prime disappear. Well, of course, they're going to be sitting on top of A and B, so we don't need the A prime and B prime anymore. So let's look at that, how some of that works. So the B prime, let's go to its settings and advanced. So remember, this is the and you get that by typing the double ampersand. So we're saying that whenever A is true, and A is the first checkbox, so when A is true and the slider value is gr less than 4.9, we're going to show that. Okay, so let's ditch that. And you can see that when we get up here above 4.9, the blue and the green disappear. Here, let me get rid of this, right? You can see that the blue and the green disappear right there on the last click, and it f sits in. So that's how you make that happen. Is there anything else? I think those were the only interesting ones, really, that required much thought other than. Oh, how to make this. So that was kind of cool. Let me show you this. We start with them here, and we can hide this slider, right? And notice me pushing play. I don't know if you saw that, but watch this, right? It's on pause right now, right? So here it's just sitting there paused, ready to be played. I push play, and then when I click on 2, it'll start moving. And how did I get that to happen? Well, That's a pretty cool effect as well. Let me just pause this for a second, and I want to go look at the properties of the slider. And look at the slider, and here's the trick, is that the speed is set to B. So this checkbox, its name is B. And if you set the name of a checkbox as the speed of your slider, then if you have it set to play, then when you check the box, it'll animate. And so you'll notice that I did the increasing, but only play once. So that those effects combined together make the slider start animating when I uncheck the box. Let's do that again so you can see it. I'm going to uncheck it, slide it back to its beginning position, and hit play. I hit play while the box is unchecked, right? And then that means that when I hit the checkbox, it starts moving. All right, so that's all I have for you. Just had a little fun with some animations and thought I'd show you that. And the Hinge theorem is actually quite useful. It's one way we can go about proving the side-side-side congruence theorem. So if you have that theorem, this might be one good way to prove that theorem involves the Hinge theorem. And I'll be back with more. This finishes up my proofs for section two in chapter two in neutral geometry. And my next big task is the Sicari-Legendre theorems from the third section of neutral geometry.